There's mind, there's ego, and there's you. And when you have more control of the mind than the mind stream, and you're more aware of the workings of ego, then you'll have more success, more opportunity, more ability to operate as you rather than as these false forms of you that co-opt you. And we're conditioned this way, so we're not totally to blame, but our responsibility is to become who we really are, not be led by the ego, which is a false self, and conflate ourselves, believe ourselves to be our thoughts, which is the mind identification. So ego and mind are often, not literally and not in every moment, but so much so that they're essentially synonymous. We kind of live as if they were the same thing. They end up holding hands so routinely that, and helping each other so routinely, they kind of become one. So whenever you notice that you're being fooled by your mind, you can call that ego. You can make it simple. Call it one thing. Call it mind, call it ego, but choose your word so that you don't have to have multiple concepts about it. And you can make it easier to separate, because that separation, what's me and what's mind, what's ego, is helpful to be more and more aware and more discerning in being able to do that. So, because ego is away from God, mind is selfishly oriented and therefore also away from God. And if you're trying to get to God, which, like I already said and say frequently, everyone who listens to me is trying to get to God. All spiritual seekers are in that mode. Your mind can't get to God. Your ego can't get to God. Only you can. So the spiritual requirement is that you become more and more you. More and more awareness means more and more aware also of what's you and what's a process that's operating but isn't actually you. Mind is certainly there, and in some ways it's an essential, but it isn't the whole story. It isn't the definition of you. And ego is a complete add-on. There was no ever any necessity for ego to be there in the way that it's there in human beings nowadays. You have to remember how recent this all is. Last 200 or 300 years. You have to remember that scientists say that Homo sapiens have been around for 40 to 80,000 years identifiably, which of course means double, triple, quadruple that number. So hundreds of thousands of years, humanity has lived without solid egos and without being the victim of their mind stream, and has been more directly in contact with life in its fullness, nature in its true operation, God in God's actual living presence. And it's only the last few hundred years where we've become mind-centered in a profound way, where we deny the science of the soul and think the science of the outer world is science. So you have to put that in proportion too. If it was a clock, then you'd be talking about the last few hundred years only. The way we feel and experience today is a phenomenon of just the last few hundred years. For hundreds of thousands of years before that, people didn't operate this way, didn't feel this way, and didn't have this experience. They were more at one with everything. And if you think of it as a clock, the rest of the history of humanity, it's the whole, if you call that the whole 24 hours, how we tend to function and how life works for us is 1 second on the clock. We've only been this way for 1 second. But for most of human history, we've been much more connected, much more earth grounded, much more connected to the not just the forces of nature, but the actuality of the living God. So we are much more divorced from reality than we've ever been. It's from what we are in 1 second of a 24-hour period, where for the rest of that 24 hours, human people have been essentially in better shape. They're more in tune with reality, more in tune with the cosmic forces and cosmic processes at work and as they operate. And it's this 1 second of time right now in the last few hundred years. We think of a few hundred years as a long time. A lot of conventional people at least do, but it's not. It's 1 second on the human clock. So we've been very mixed up for 1 second and not anywhere near as mixed up. Screwed up, yes, because we've been killing each other all along. But we haven't been this mixed up before about, there hasn't been this thing before about is there God, isn't there God? And what's, the questions haven't been as jumbled as they are now. And we haven't been as blind as we are now. So this is the dark age. And in the dark age, nothing changes in terms of the individual quest for the truth, quest for God, quest for self. So it's not a reason for pessimism. It's just you have to understand that the nature of things and the way people operate and the way things tend to work these days are less favorable for the divine quest than in times past. That's just how it is. You know, if you're living in the Sahara Desert, you want to learn how to swim, it's not exactly favorable conditions, but there's things you can do. So if the conditions are less favorable, that doesn't mean you should be pessimistic, and that doesn't mean you shouldn't be going on the quest, that you should be changing your mind that life is not about finding God. It's just the circumstances are a little less conducive than they've tended to be for most of the history of life on this planet.